رمضان هل هلاله وظلاله وجماله رمضان.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. This is Sheikh Fakhr al-Din Uwaisi from Cape Town, greeting you with the greetings of peace and mercy from the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept your fast, accept your tilawatul Qur'an, accept your salatul taraweeh, accept your sadaqas and charities. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all your du'as and our du'as in this blessed month of Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the tawfiq to fulfill whatever he requires of us in this month in a manner that pleases him and not in a manner that displeases him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the hidayah to fast and pray and spend in this month in a way that will make us gain his pleasure. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. Alhamdulillah, we were talking about the akhlaq of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has praised our Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam's character by saying, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. Indeed, O Muhammad, you have the best of characters. So alhamdulillah, we are honored that our Nabi is not just the Nabi who had the best of worship or the best of revelations or the best of miracles or the best of followers or the best of gifts from Allah, but we are honored that our Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam is the one who was given by Allah the best of character, the best of akhlaq. Because ultimately, what remains after somebody leaves this dunya is the memory of his character, his akhlaq. People are not going to count how much money you had. People are not going to remember, what you used to dress like. Or people are not going to remember what you used to eat. But what remains in the memories of people is what type of person you were. That's what makes people love you or hate you. And our Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam was the most lovable of all creation, the most adorable of all creation, the most gentle of all creation alayhi salatu wasalam. Indeed, as the Sahaba radiallahu anhum stated that وَأَحْسَنُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَرَى قَطُّ عَيْنِي وَأَجْمَلُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَلِدِ النِّسَاءُ خُلِقْتَ مُبَرَّأً مِنْ كُلِّ عَيْبٍ كَأَنَّكَ قَدْ خُلِقْتَ كَمَا تَشَاءُ. Sayyidina Hassan bin Sabit radiallahu anhu says, Ya Rasulullah, more better than you my eyes have never seen, and more beautiful than you no woman has given birth to. Indeed, Ya Rasulullah, you were created so perfectly as if you yourself designed how you would be in this world. In other words, if I was given the chance to design myself, I would design myself to be the most perfect person. So he says that in the point that, Ya Rasulullah, indeed you are created in such a perfect manner as if you created yourself. So indeed, our Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, of course, is created by Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, and Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala made him the most perfect of all people. So alhamdulillah, we were speaking the last time about the hilm of the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the forbearance of the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam with people. And really, forbearance is one of those qualities that we are always in need of, because throughout life, not everybody is going to be gentle to you, not everybody is going to be nice to you, not everybody is going to treat you in a nice manner, not everybody is going to be fair with you. People always upset you. Always in life, we get people who are upsetting us or, inciting us, irritating us, stressing us. And in all of that, what is required is for us to have hilm, for us to have forbearance, especially with the people who are under us, who we have the power to punish them and attack them, but we don't do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hilm, as I explained in the previous episode, is not sabr. Sabr is when somebody who has power over you does something to hurt you, and you have patience, and you don't respond, and you control your anger. That's sabr. Hilm is when somebody who is under your control mistreats you or incites you or does something to irritate you, and you have the power to punish them. They are under your control, but you don't do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is hilm. So really, hilm is the quality of great people, because it's not easy to have hilm. Sabr is still easier, because you are having patience with somebody that is oppressing you, who is more powerful than you. So sometimes you are forced to have sabr because you have no option, you know, but sabr. You can't respond to that person. They are more powerful than you. But hilm is when they have more power than you. Hilm is when you have more power than them. So you have the power to punish that person. You have the authority to scold that person. You have that control to, you know, express your anger at that person. But you don't do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is hilm. And our Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, kana ahlam al-nas, he was the most halim, the most forbearing of all people. There's an incident that one day our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam was traveling with the Sahaba on one expedition, and while they were going to fight this one tribe that had kind of like rebelled against Islam and was making war against the Muslims, they went to the area, to the land of this tribe, and then they camped outside there. And there were many trees around there, so different Sahaba camped under different trees. And the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam also found himself a tree, and he laid down under that tree. And what he did was, he hung his sword on a branch of that tree, on top of him. So he hung the sword on the branch of the tree, and he laid down to rest and relax and have an afternoon sleep. So as the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam is sleeping, suddenly he hears some sound, and then he sees, when he opens his eyes, he sees that there is a man standing in front of him, kind of like on top of him. And this man has taken the sword and is looking at the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, and he is one of the tribe that he had come to fight. So he looks at the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam and he says, Ya Muhammad, who will protect you from me? So he's looking at the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he's saying, who will protect you from me now, Ya Muhammad? I mean, you are laying on the floor, I'm standing right there by your head, and I've got your sword in my hand. One hit and I can kill you right now, and I can end this deen of Islam once and for all. We don't even need to have a battle after that. If you are dead, khalas, Islam is finished. Who can protect you from me, Ya Muhammad? So the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam looks at that man and he says, Allah. Again, the man says, who can protect you from me, Ya Muhammad? The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam, calm and cool, he says, Allah. Again, the man says, who can protect you from me now? Who's going to save you now if I want to kill you now? Who can save you, Ya Muhammad? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, Allah. The third time, when our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam says Allah, the man starts shaking and his hand starts shaking and he starts trembling and his sword falls from his hands. So the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam then picks up the sword and he stands in front of that man and he says, O man, who can protect you from me now? Who can protect you from me now? So the man just looks at the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam and he begs for his life. He says, don't kill me, Ya Muhammad. I have heard that you are a most generous man. And I have heard that you are a most kind man. And I have heard that you are a most gentle man. So the man sits down out of fear that the Nabi is going to kill him now. And if the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam had to kill that man at that moment, he would have done nothing wrong, because this man came to kill him. He's a warrior, he's an enemy soldier in the first place, and he comes to kill me. This is my chance to kill him, and it won't be anything wrong or unfair. Nobody's going to blame him for that. So the man sits down quietly, and the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, you have spoken the truth. And he leaves the man. Then by this time, the Sahaba, they hear the commotion, and they all come running towards the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam. And they see this man sitting in front of the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. And they see the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam standing with the sword, and they ask him, what happened, Ya Rasulullah? The Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam explained to them the entire story. He says, this is what happened. This man wanted to kill me, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the sword fall off from his hand. and I got the sword now. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, instinctively, immediately, they wanted to attack that man and kill the man or take him as a prisoner. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them, leave the man alone. Just leave him alone. And then the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam and the Sahaba, they left. And then that man left and went back to his tribe. There is a narration that mentions that when the man went back to his tribe, he was one of the leaders of the tribe. The people of his tribe asked him, what happened? Did you kill him, anybody? He said, I was about to kill their leader, Muhammad. But I couldn't do it. And let me tell you something, O my people. When I went to fight that Muhammad, I used to consider him the worst of people. But I want to tell you now that indeed he is the best of people. He is the best of people. Alayhi salatu wassalam wa alihi al-kiram. At that juncture, that entire tribe then comes with that leader again the next day. And they accept Islam. And those who don't accept Islam make a peace treaty with the Muslims. And there is no fighting. And alhamdulillah, nobody dies from the kuffar or from the Muslimin. So this is the effect of the akhlaq of the Nabi alayhi salatu wassalam. Just by having hilm with that man and forgiving that man and not retaliating against that man, the result was that that entire tribe came into Islam and came into peace with the Muslims, and nobody had to fight, nobody had to get killed, nobody had to get hurt. So this is the akhlaq of the Nabi alayhi salatu wassalam. Let us also have hilm in our interactions with our people at our workplace, in our schools, in our homes. With your children have hilm, with your wife have hilm, with your employees, your workers have hilm, with your students at school have hilm. This is the month of hilm, this is the month of patience, this is the month of restraint. If we cannot restrain ourselves in Ramadan, when will we then restrain ourselves? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the tawfiq to have hilm in this blessed month of Ramadan so that our fast can be acceptable and presentable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله وأصحابه أجمعين
رمضان
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. We come back to our discussion on the beautiful akhlaq of this Prophet سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. Subhanallah, it's a joy and a pleasure to speak of our Nabi alayhi salatu wassalam. Just hearing about him alayhi salatu wassalam fills our hearts and our souls and our minds and illuminates us inwardly and outwardly. Alhamdulillah, we can never thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enough for granting us this Nabi alayhi salatu wassalam. Alhamdulillah, we're talking about the akhlaq of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam and how our Nabi alayhi salatu wassalam had the best of akhlaq. And we had spoken about hilm and forbearance, but we want to speak now, inshallah, about another quality of our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that is the quality of tawadu. Tawadu means humility. And it is amazing that just as our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is known to be the khayrun nas, the best of people, he is also known to be as the most humblest of people. And subhanAllah, the two are interlinked, because the greater you are, the humbler you be. The higher you are in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's eyes, the more humble you become. And the more humble you become in, with people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises you up more. So the more humbler you are, the more greater you are as well in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's eyes, the more you are raised up. The Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, تَوَاضَعُوا لِلَّهِ فَمَن تَوَاضَعَ لِلَّهِ رَفَعَهُ اللَّهِ. He says, humble yourselves for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For indeed, whosoever humbles himself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise him up. Whoever humbles himself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise him up. وَقَدْ أَمَرَنِ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَىٰ أَنْ أَتَوَاضَعَ. And indeed, my Rabb has ordered me to have humility. So, as we are fasting, let us always maintain our humility with all people. It is very common for us, to become arrogant and become self-righteous. And we feel we are better than people. Sometimes we feel we are better than people because of our race. I am white or I am whatever. Or you are black and you are so on. And our race, or I'm from this family or that family. Sometimes we become arrogant with people because of our wealth. I'm so rich and you are so poor. So, you just feel because I'm a rich person, I can just speak to people the way I want to, and especially those who don't have the type of wealth that I have. Or sometimes we become arrogant because of our knowledge as well. You feel I'm a scholar and I'm a sheikh, or I'm a very learned man, I'm a professor, so I have the right to be arrogant with people. Sometimes it's because of even our deen. So you feel that just because I'm a Muslim, automatically I have a right to look down on other people who are not Muslims and just treat them as lesser human beings. Or sometimes it can even be our good deeds. Just because I'm a pious person and I go to the masjid or I fast and I do some good deeds, I am better than others, and I can be arrogant with others and I can be rude with others. Brothers and sisters in Islam, this is not the akhlaq of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Our Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam used to be humble with all people, with all creation, not only people, even with animals and birds. Our Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam had that humility and akhlaq, because he sees everything as coming from Allah. He sees everything as the creation of Allah. So when he sees that everything is from Allah and by Allah and in Allah, then our Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam then has that absolute humility with everything. Because therefore his humility is not actually for people and for creation, it's humility for Allah. When he humbles himself in front of the creation of Allah, he's actually humbling himself in front of Allah. And that's the intention. I'm not saying that we have to be humiliating ourselves in front of other human beings for the sake of other human beings. No. But we have to be humble for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Treat everybody in a just and fair manner. Treat everybody in the best of manners, in fact. So our Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam was really like that. So many beautiful stories of our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam regarding this. One of the stories is the story, a beautiful story during the Battle of Badr. When the Sahaba radiallahu anhum went to fight in the Battle of Badr, they had one camel for three men. So three people had to share one camel, because the Muslims were poor and they didn't have these camels and these animals, as opposed to the Kuffar, where each one was riding his own horse and his own camel. The Muslims, three men had to share one camel. So the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam shared his camel with Sayyidina al-Imam Ali bin Abi Talib and Sayyidina Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhuma. So these were the two Sahaba, Ali and Abu Lubaba, one from the Muhajirin, one from the Ansar, who were sharing the camel with the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. So what happened then was that first the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam was riding, and as the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam's turn was finished and it was now the turn of Ali and then the turn of Abu Lubaba, both of them, they looked at the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam and said, Ya Rasulullah, we give up our turns for you. So you can keep on riding the camel, Ya Rasulullah. We give up our turns, Ya Rasulullah. So it's fine. You don't have to get down and so I have to go up. You can carry on. So the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam looked at them and he said that, Ma antuma bi aqwa minni wa ma ana bi aghna min al ajri minkuma. He said, you are not stronger than me, and I am not in less need of the reward than you. So indeed, you need the ride as well like I need it, and I need the sawab as well as you need it. So subhanallah, the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam gets down from the camel and he lets Ali radiallahu anhu ride. And then after that, when Ali's turn is finished, then Abu Lubaba gets on the camel and he rides. And then after that, the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam rides. The people saw that this is the leader of the army, this is the leader of the nation, this is the leader of the Ummah, and he is walking while his companions are riding. Subhanallah, that is tawadu, that is humility, that is akhlaq of the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. You even see that when he came into Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara, and when he entered the city of Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara, he was with Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anh, and when he entered Medina and they all sat down in one of the gardens of the Ansar Ridwanullahi alayhim, and then the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam is sitting there and Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq stands up. So a lot of the Ansar, the Muslims of Medina, they start coming and greeting Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anh, thinking that he is the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And then Sayyidina Abu Bakr then takes up his shawl and he covers our Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam with the shawl so that everybody can notice that is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. But the point of the story was that the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam was so humble that many a times people who had not seen him before, they couldn't even recognize him from his companions. And indeed, the Sahaba say, Wallahi, we would sit with the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, all of us together next to him, that a newcomer would come in the gathering and he wouldn't know which one is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He used to sit with his companions like he was one of them. He didn't have a special chair there. He didn't have a special, you know, a pillow there that he sits on. He didn't have a special cushion. He didn't have even a special dress. He didn't dress differently. I mean, today, if you are an important person, you stand out in the gathering because you sit on a nice chair and you have a special chair and you look differently from everybody else. You dress differently from everybody else. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he didn't dress differently from anybody else. He used to dress just like the rest of the Sahaba. He used to sit down with them in the gathering. The way they are sitting on the floor, he sits with them just like that. Nobody knows who he is unless they actually ask the Sahaba, which one is the Prophet? This is the humility of the best of creation, alayhi salatu wasalam. Where is our humility today? Today, if you have a little bit of money, a little bit of knowledge, a little bit of family pride, and we automatically think everybody must treat me better than everybody else. We don't want to greet people. We say, people must greet me. Yet the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, who was the greatest of all people, he would greet everybody first. The Sahaba say, one of the akhlaq of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam was that, kana yabda'u an-nasa bis-salam wal atfal, that he sallallahu alayhi wasalam would greet people first, even if they were children. SubhanAllah, in today's time, who greets children? If we come into a gathering and we see children, then we don't, let alone greeting them first, we don't even greet them. But the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he comes in a gathering, before the people can greet him, he greets everybody. And before, you know, the children, then he goes and he greets all the children as well. That's why the children loved him, the adults loved him, the slaves loved him, everybody loved him. The kuffar even, as much as they didn't accept him, but they loved him because of his akhlaq, alayhi salatu wasalam. He told us, Sallim ala man ta'arif al man lam ta'arif. Greet the people that you know and the ones you don't know. Today, if you don't know somebody, we don't want to greet them. And even if we know somebody, we want them to come greet us first because I am more important, I am more rich, I am so and so. So I'm the scholar and I'm the whatever. So let us follow the sunnah of the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. While we, especially in Ramadan, while we are fasting, it's the best time to practice the akhlaq of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam. And you know, in our interactions, people must see your employer, you know, your workers that work with you, the non-Muslims, they must see that in the month of Ramadan, you are a changed person. They must see that it's not only that my boss doesn't have breakfast and lunch in Ramadan, but besides that, my boss totally becomes like an angel in the month of Ramadan. His akhlaq, his character, he greets us first. He shakes our hand. He smiles at us. He, you know, gives us extra pay. The Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, in the month of Ramadan, Allah increases the rizq of people. So really, in the month of Ramadan, pay your non-Muslim workers extra, and your Muslim workers as well. Pay them extra in the month of Ramadan, because this is the month Allah pays us extra. This is the month in which Allah increases our rizq. So show, you know, this akhlaq in Ramadan. The Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, part of the akhlaq of Ramadan is to treat your workers nicely, treat your slaves nicely. So let everybody else around us see the effect of Ramadan on us, the effect of the fast on us, so that Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala can accept our fast and please with us and then reward us abundantly from His treasures in dunya and akhirah for that fast, which is the real fast. Wa sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.
Soul Food continues with Thought of the Day, Arabic is Fun, and health tips from Tib.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to today's Thought for the Day. Dhunnun Misri Rahmatullah Alayhi was a great saint. He was a great servant of Allah. One day somebody questioned him. They came to him and they asked him, how do we recognize the special servants of Allah? Those who are close to Allah, those who are chosen servants of Allah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, how do we recognize them? He said, they have four qualities. They have four qualities. You will recognize them by four qualities. What's the first? A chosen servant of Allah forsakes ease and comfort. A chosen servant of Allah forsakes ease and comfort. Now we need to understand this very carefully. Sometimes we think that, you know, ease and comfort is haram in Islam and we frown upon it. No, we need to reconcile the different principles of Sharia very nicely. For example, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has taught us, Whenever you have two options, go for the easy option. Go for the option in which there is more ease, there is more comfort. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has also taught us, سَلِلَّهَ الْعَافِيَةِ. Ask Allah for ease, ask Allah for comfort. So on the apparent, it may seem like a contradiction. The Nabi of Allah tells us we must ask Allah for ease. He tells us we must take the easier of the two options. And here the Noon Misri rahmatullah alayhi is saying that the first quality of the special servants of Allah is that they forsake ease and comfort. What is meant here is they do not hanker after the comforts of this world. They do not hanker after it all the time, all the time. If you have this level of comfort, you want a greater level of comfort, a greater level of comfort, a greater level of comfort. They have understood, the special servants of Allah, they have understood that this world is the prison of a believer. This world will have its difficulties, its challenges. Yes, when they supplicate to Allah, they ask for ease. They don't show bravery in front of Allah. When they have two options, they go for the easier one. Because when you got two options and both are permissible, and you go for the more difficult one, you are showing bravery and courage when Allah has given you an easier option. So we wish for ease, yes. And when we have an option, we go the easier route, as long as both are equally permissible. But we understand, or we ought to understand, the chosen servants of Allah understand, life is not full of ease and comfort. Life cannot only be about ease and comfort. You have to leave the comfort of your bed in the early parts of the morning to perform your Fajr Salah. You have to delay the comfort of your bed at night to perform your Isha Salah. You have to separate some of your wealth and give in charity, even though it may make you feel uncomfortable. So in that sense, this chosen servant of Allah is not obsessed with ease and comfort. He can give it up. For him, he understands he's here for a temporary period. He's like a wayfarer. He's a traveler in this world. He's not too obsessed with, you know, the finer things that are going to take him to the highest levels of comfort. So that's the first sign of the chosen servant of Allah, according to the Noon Misri. The second, he spends from whatever little he has in his possessions. He spends from whatever little he has in his possessions. Notice here, he didn't say that a chosen servant of Allah, one of the qualities and signs are that he spends a lot. No, everybody is not in the position to spend a lot. If you are and you do, that's noble, that's great. But whatever little you have, so what do we learn from this? The special servants of Allah, even if they are in need themselves, they take out a little from whatever little they have and they share. They give in charity. Now you and I, we may be living hand to mouth, you know, as they say. We may be just breaking even. We may be just our noses above the water, not even the full head, or maybe just the nose and the mouth, we're just able to breathe. Then too, if it's a 50 cent or a rand, or it's by virtue of your time or your experience, give something or the other in the path of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Spend a little from the little that you have for the pleasure of Allah. The third quality of a special servant of Allah, a chosen servant, he's content with a lowly status in this world. He's not hankering after fame. If it comes, fine, it's from Allah. If Allah makes it such that people love him, people respect him, he's become famous amongst people, so be it. But it's not a criteria in his life. He doesn't do it because it will secure him recognition. If there's recognition, well and good. If there's no recognition, for him it's immaterial. It doesn't make a difference. He continues with it. So that's the third quality. And that's also something we need to realize. Whatever we do, it mustn't bother us whether there will be recognition or they won't, whether people know what we do or they don't, whether people recognize and acknowledge us or they don't. And the fourth thing, he says, praises and insults are the same to him. He listens to praise. If it's valid, he says, Alhamdulillah, it's from Allah. If it's not valid, it doesn't bother him because he was doing it for Allah anyway, not for people. And the insults, if it's valid, he looks to remedy himself. If it's not valid, well, people's tongues you can never control. So he's not motivated or demotivated. He's not motivated by praise. He's not demotivated by insults. Why? Because he's sincere. He's focused on Allah and Allah alone. So the Noon Misri rahmatullah alayhi, to recap, was asked one day, that how do we recognize the special and the chosen servants of Allah? He said they have four qualities. The first, they are not obsessed with ease and comfort. The second, from whatever little they have, they spend. The third, they are content with the lowly status in this world. And the fourth, whether you praise them or you insult them, it's the same to them because they are focused on only doing things for the pleasure of Allah. May Allah grant us the tawfiq. That was today's thought for the day. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Welcome to Ramadan Tips from Tibbs. with Dr. Mujeeb Hussain and myself. Today we shall talk about the importance of food and medicine, food as medicine. Dr. Mujeeb, can you fill us in on this very important subject during this holy month of Ramadan?
Throughout the history of medicine, which began with Hippocrates in his famous statement, make food your medicine and medicine your food. And we find that Muslim physicians followed this theory. It is well established in the Sunnah where the Prophet ﷺ advised the Sahaba to seek pure foods. From the Quran ayah that tells us to seek the foods that are halalan tayyiba. Tayyiba refers to wholesome, pure foods from the earth. Today, modern medical science in the field of nutritional medicine recognizes that foods contain more than just nutrition or nutrients. It contains phytochemicals. So everything you eat can either lead towards health promotion or it can lead towards disease. So understand that food is medicine.
Thank you, Mujeeb. So as my colleague has mentioned, it's not only important how the food tastes, but let us look at the nutritional value of foods and remember that food is medicine. Jazakallah khair from Dr. Mujeeb Hussain and myself. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
عشواشو في العشوة عشوة فيها لمة عشوة تسد قلبك في برنامج عشوة في برنامج عشوة لا 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 لا
Assalamu alaikum, nahmaduhu wa nusalli ala rasulihil kareem, and welcome to Arabic is Fun. And of course, today the second of Ramadan. I hope that you had a wonderful day, that is your first song went well. And of course, we continue with this very first lesson, and I hope some of you may have, of course, practiced the writing. And remember what I told you, take two pens and alternate them, and you'll see, you'll learn how each letter appears in the beginning, in the center, in the end, and when it is alone, and thereby you can actually learn to read even easier and at the same time even write the Arabic. But today we are going to discuss in our lesson two, what we are going to discuss, articles. Now you see, the articles plays a very important part in Arabic. And the articles will mean when we express a thing as the or a, when we say the. For instance, if I say a book, I mean any book. If I say the boy, if I say the boy is here, then you know I'm referring to a particular boy. But if I say a boy is here, it means just any boy. So in Arabic, this expression of the and a is a very important thing. Like for instance, if I say the girl has come, it means I know which girl I'm referring to. But I say a girl has come, so it means just anyone. Do you see the difference between the and a? Now when you look at the, because we are definite, if I say, right, the cameraman, if I say the cameraman or a cameraman, I say the cameraman, right, so maybe I'm referring to a particular cameraman, maybe Yusuf. But if I say a cameraman, it could be just anyone, you see. So when we use the, and when we use, of course, for indefinite article, we are not sure, we use a or we use an, right? We say a boy is here, an apple, I ate an apple. It means I just ate any apple, but if I say I ate the apple, so it means the particular apple that you are talking about. So, in English, when we talk about definite article, we say the book, the man, the girl, the pen, the sun, the moon. You see, I mean a particular item. But if I say indefinite, I say a book, I read a book. You don't know which book, it's just any book. A man walked into the studio. Right, a girl boarded the bus, a boy ran a marathon, a sun was seen, a moon. You see, so you find that these are all indefinite, you are not sure. So now you know in Arabic what we call the vowel. We are used to this zabar, zer, pesh, and you see in the fatha, when you have that stroke above a letter, we call it fatha, and it's equivalent to an ah sound, ah. I mean, I'm not going to go and do all that. Now, when you look at a kasra, what we call a zer, it means E sound, E, not A. Please make sure it's not A, it is E, ihdina siratal. Now, when you have this dhamma, which we call pesh, of course, in Farsi, in the Persian language, and people of the Indo-Pak, they use that as pesh. We call this a dhamma in Arabic, but pesh. Now, when you have a double vowel is called a tanween, a tanween. Now, you find that these two dhamma is like 69 if you look at it. Right, it is double vowel, what we call a dopesh in the Indo-Pak. Right, it is called a dhamma tan, but we call it a double dhamma. You see, double dhamma. I'm not going to say double or dhamma tan. I'll just call it dhamma tan. And in Arabic script, to write that 69, the double dhamma, we even write it like that. Please note they are the same. So now look at this. Whenever you have a double vowel, whether it is double fatha, double dhamma, or double kasra, we call it tanween. Tanween means double. Tanween means double. But as a rule, if you read the Quran, remember the Quran is our best book that we can use as far as finding out the rules. Now, if whatever you learn, you'll find that if you read the Quran, you'll be able to observe how these rules are. Whenever a double fatha appears, it is always followed by an alif, if you notice. Read the Quran, wherever there's double fatha, you see it is followed by an alif, except on a hamza or a feminine round ta. Now let us see in Arabic how we are going to express this A or N. Now you know the word for book is kitab. The book word for book is kitab. Now if I have got a double dhamma there, what is that? A double dhamma, as I told you, it is equivalent to that double dhamma, 69, what we have, right? So how would I read this? I'm going to read this as kitabun. Now please notice, I'm not teaching you tajweed here, therefore I'm going to read every sound, I'm going to read it in full throughout these lessons. I'm not going to say kitab. Somebody will say, no, it is kitab, but I'm teaching you the rules of grammar, and therefore I have to read the vowels in full, like kitabun. Kitabun. Now what do you notice here? Kitab means book. Do you observe anything? When the tanween comes, we have said A. We have said A. So would you say, what is kitabun? Now look at this same thing. Al-kitabu. Al-kitabu. Now look at this. Al. Right. And what happened? Because we have added al here, when we added the al, we do not use the dhamma anymore. We do not use the dhamma, we use a single vowel. So in other words, when you add al, the vowel on the last letter becomes a single letter. Single. So al-kitabu, we have translated that as the book. Look at another word, baytun. Baytun, a house. Baytun, a house. Now, do you see any similarity now? When you use a tanween, right, a double dhamma, we have said A. Bayt, of course, is a house. Now, why you say al-baytu? Now, al, what did we translate it as? The. And what did you do when al comes here? You notice that dhamma has disappeared. It's become a single vowel here. Single. Now, look at this. Waladun. Waladun is a boy. Waladun, a boy. What is A? What did A tell you? He told me that is the double dhamma gave you A. Now, al-waladu, what has become here now? Al, when we added al, al had become the. You follow? So whenever we added that al, notice now I'm going to teach you to the deductive method. You have to see and you have to deduce what has happened here. Look at al-waladu, al. When you add it. Now, what is waladun? What are the differences between the two words? Look at this. On the one side, we have waladun. We have it to the tanween ye, but al-waladu is the other side. So what would you say waladun means? And what is al-waladu? Right. What part of the word in Arabic means the? Can you tell me what part of the word means the? Which one was the? Now, look at this. What part of the word in Arabic meant a? If I say a book, how would I express a book? You see, so now what is the thing here is now, do you notice whenever you have to add waladun, tanween is a, and al waladu, when you have al, So we have da. Now, did you learn something here today? Did you learn a very simple rule that if you take any word, take this word here, al-baytu, the house, when you added al. But baytun, what is baytun? The tanween means a. And similarly, al-kitabu, what is al? Al is da. Look at this. Kitabun, a book. Right. And because it's tanween, so I would say tanween means a. And al means da. And of course, we have come to this end of this lesson, of this lesson number 2. And in this lesson, what we have dealt with? We have dealt with the definite article. Whenever any word has al, of course, we talk about common noun. I can't put al-Muhammad. Muhammad is a proper name, right? But on common nouns, a boy, chair, table, house, etc. So when I add al, it means the. But when you add al, you cannot use a tanween. So you can't say the a book. You understand? And waladun. And of course, what you notice here now, that these lessons, as I've told you, are derived from a course that is consisting of 12 DVDs plus 4 books. And it is called Arabic is Fun, and your inquiries are there. And of course, shukran for watching. We have come to the end of this program. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
في برنامج عشوى لا 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 رمضان.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. This is Sheikh Fakhruddin Uwaisi greeting you from the city of Cape Town. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's peace and blessings and mercy be upon all of you. Every Muslim who says La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you and guide you and protect you and give you the tawfiq to fulfill the requirements of this month of Ramadan. We go back to the akhlaq of the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. This is the month of akhlaq. If we cannot have akhlaq in this month of Ramadan, then we can never ever have akhlaq. If we cannot try to follow the akhlaq of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the manners of our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, while we are fasting, then we can never ever get there. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the tawfiq to follow his example and learn about his example. We were speaking about the tawadu', the humility of our Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam. Indeed, while being the best of creation, the greatest of creation, to witnessing the arsh and the malaika, And all these creations of Allah, subhanAllah, he was even granted the vision of Allah himself. Yet, despite having all these great gifts from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was the humblest of people. His wife, as Sayyid Aisha radiallahu anha, says, and indeed, our Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, kana, you know, yakhsifu na'lahu wa yakhsilu sawbahu. He used to fix his own sandals, you know, when the sandal breaks, he fixes it on his own. See, you see him sitting there on the floor, on the earth, busy fixing his own sandals. SubhanAllah, when do you see that? Today, if I'm a rich man, I'm a big business owner, and my sandals breaks, you're not going to see me sitting on the floor fixing my own sandal. I'll just buy a new one or ask somebody else to fix it. But our Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, like that. How beautiful mustn't it have been to witness him like that? It's Aisha says, he used to fix his own sandals. He used to stitch his own soaps. If his top is torn, then, you know, he ﷺ would sit down on the floor and start stitching it and making those patches in it. He had many patches in it. One day, Sayyidah Aisha said, Ya Rasulullah, why do you have all these patches in your soap? Why don't you just buy a new one? And the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam tells her that, you know, as long as I can patch it, I don't need a new one. This is the humility of the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Kana yu'inu ahlahu, he alayhi salatu wasalam, he used to help his family members, his wives, in their household duties, wherever he can. He, alayhi salatu wasalam, used to feed his own animals. I mean, today, if you don't wash your own car, if you are a very rich man and a famous man, you pay somebody to wash your car. But the Nabi, alayhi salatu wasalam, he would go and feed his own horse and camel. He feeds them himself, alayhi salatu wasalam. That was his humility, his akhlaq with all people. We see that when he used to be, when he finishes his salah, alayhi salatu wasalam, when he makes assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, he used to ask the sahaba, hal fikum marid a'uduh, هل فيكم ميت ميت ليصلي عليه؟ Is there any mayyit amongst you that I can perform his janazah? Is there any sick person amongst you so that I can go visit? And the Sahaba say, wallahi, the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to visit all the sick people of Medina and perform salah on all the dead people of Medina, even if they were the poorest of the poor. Today, if a very important guy becomes sick, we all rush to the hospital to see him. But if a poor man becomes sick, we don't bother to go visit him, even if it's our neighbor. If a rich man dies, we all want to attend his janazah. But if a poor man dies, if the muazzin of the masjid dies, or somebody poor dies, we are not interested. But the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam used to visit the poor people. Kana sallallahu alayhi wasallam yazur al-fuqara'a wal-masakeen wa ijlisu ma'ahum wa ya'kulu ma'ahum wa yushayyu janaizahum wa yu'udu mardahum. The Sahaba say the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to visit the poor people and the despondent and the destitute people. He used to sit with them in their homes. He used to eat with them from the same plate. And he would attend their janazas and see to their sick people. And وَلَا يَحْقِرُ فَقِيرًا. And never ever did the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam look down upon a poor person. Wallahi, many a times he would sit down with the poor people. There is a beautiful narration that one day he was sitting outside and on the stoop, as we say, and he was eating the food outside. And this is not usually what the big people of the time would do at that time. So a woman comes, and she was known to be a crazy woman in Medina, somebody that's not, you know, mentally stable. So she comes and she looks at the Prophet and she says, oh, look at you, Muhammad, the Prophet. You sit here on the stoop like a slave and you eat like a slave. Because the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam would not eat reclining. He would always eat like the slaves sit and eat. So she calls him like that. She insults him in front of the Sahaba. So the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam smiles and he looks at her and he says, by Allah, I am a slave. I am a slave of Allah. Then the woman looks at him. She says, then I want to eat something of this food. So the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Bismillah. She says, no, I want to eat from your plate. He says, Bismillah. Then she says, no, I want to eat from the same spot that you were eating from, Ya Muhammad. So the Nabi alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam picks up that plate and shows her, Bismillah. Then she puts her hand right where the Nabi alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was eating from. And she picks up that and she eats it. Subhanallah, the Sahaba says she eats that and she leaves. And they say, by Allah, this woman was known to be running around the roads of Medina often. You know, she's not covered properly, her hijab is not on, and because she was a crazy woman. They say, wallahi, after she ate from the plate of the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, they never ever saw her on the street again. It transformed her totally. But this is the barakah of the akhlaq of the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. When the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, you know, conquered the city of Makkah, he entered Makkah not like a conqueror. This is the city that oppressed him for 20 years. Yet he enters Makkah with all humility. The Sahaba say, wallahi, he was so humble when he entered Makkah. He was wearing a black turban and his head was low and lowered. They said his head was so lowered that it was touching the neck of his camel. So he was riding a camel that day and they said it was as if his head was touching the neck of his camel. Alayhi salatu wasalam, he entered Makkah in such humility and he told the people that today is not a day of victory and celebration of victory. Today is a day of humility and forgiveness and a day in which we will worship and praise our Rabb subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he enters Makkah, just after that, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq comes to him with his father. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr is walking to him with his father with a stick and he's holding his father. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq's father was a very old man by that time. So when he brings the father to the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam says, Ya Aba Bakr, kunta akhbartana an al-shaykhi fa'atainah. He said, Ya Aba Bakr, you should have told us about your father that he wants to see me, and I would have went to him. Look at that. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq's father is not a Muslim. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq's father is a kafir. And the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam is also not a young man. He's 60 by that time. And he's telling Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, why did you trouble the old man to bring him here to me? I would have went to him. I would have went and seen him. Yeah. And then Abu Bakr says, Ya Rasulullah, no. He has to come see you. I could not have let you walk to him. You are our Nabi and he is not a Muslim. But look at the humility of the humbleness of our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, even with a non-Muslim, alayhi salatu wasalam. And then the father of Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq accepts the deen of Islam and enters into Islam. And we see in another incident, our Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, even when a woman comes to him one day, a slave woman of Medina, he says, "You are our Nabi, you are supposed to help us. Can you please help me with something?" So the Nabi ﷺ said, "Yes, I will help you." She said, "No, then come with me." And the Nabi ﷺ walks with this slave woman. The entire city of Medina sees that this slave woman is walking in the front, and the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ is walking behind her. Not a maid, a slave woman. And he walks behind her till she comes to wherever she wanted to take him, and she tells him to do whatever she wanted him to do for him, and she does that for him. And then he tells her, "Are you happy now?" She says, "I am very happy. You are a good man, Ya Muhammad." And he smiles and he walks away back to the masjid to continue with his ibadah. This is the akhlaq of the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, the humility of the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Even with the lowest of people, even with the most unimportant of people, the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam was humble. He greets them nicely. One day a man came to see him and he says, "Oh Muhammad, where is Muhammad?" The Sahaba said, "This is Muhammad." So when he stands in front of the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, he starts trembling and shaking because he's overawed. He can't believe he's standing in front of Rasulullah. So he starts shaking. When he starts shaking, the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam says to the man, "Hawwin alayka ya rajul." "Take it easy, O man. Take it easy, O man. Fa'inni lastu bi malikin wala bi jabbar." "I am not a king and I'm not a tyrant." "Innama ibn imra'atin min Quraysh kanat ta'kulul qadid." "I am but the son of a woman in Makkah who used to eat dried meat." And eating dry meat was, the sign of poor people in Makkah. So the Nabi ﷺ tells them, "I'm just the son of..." He doesn't mention his father because his father passed away before he was born. So he tells the man, "Take it easy, O man. Don't be scared of me. I'm not a king. I'm not a chief. I'm not a tyrant. I'm the son of a woman in Makkah, a humble woman in Makkah that used to eat dry meat." So the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam never forgets his own asal. You know, he grew up as an orphan, as a humble person. So that is our Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Never arrogant with anybody. The children used to come to him and greet him, and he hugs them and he kisses them. He's not arrogant with them. The women of Medina come to him with sometimes with their complaints and their issues, and he talks to them and he listens to them and he listens to what they have to say. He does not, he wasn't arrogant with anybody. The Sahaba radiallahu anhu said that, "Wallahi, we did not see a human being that was more humbler than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also grant us that humility, a fraction of that humility of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so that all the people around us can see that humility in us. And may our humility be for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you see any other human being, look at him as a creation of Allah. Don't look at if he's black or white, he's a woman or a man, Muslim or a non-Muslim, rich or poor, foreigner, local, old or younger. Don't look at all that. Is he pious or not pious? Is he corrupt? Always look at him as a creation of Allah and treat him in the best of manners and be humble with him, because as the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Man tawada'a lillah rafa'ahu Allah." Whoever has humility for Allah, Allah will make him great and honorable in this dunya and akhirah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us follow the example of our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam while we fast and outside of the fast as well. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in wa akhiru da'wana أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.
رمضان هل هلاله وظلاله وجماله.